Good morning, good morning, good morning, Facebook family and friends and Temple of Faith of God Church. God bless y'all this morning. It's good to be in the land of the living. We having technical difficulties. We having a little problem trying to get in online. We're a little behind schedule, but God bless, we made it. It looks like. Are we on? Okay. Amen. My technician, she works tirelessly for the Lord. And we have to give her props, man. She got it. The Facebook messing with us again. But that's all right. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? We got to be watchful in this hour, saints. We got to make sure that our integrity is intact. We can't be jockeying for position, running over people's feet to get that power that is not from on high, that power on this earth, where you get the riches and the glitter and the gold, where moth and rust does corrupt, we'll rust it out, and it, you can't take it with you. Let's put it that way. Look for your treasures in heaven, where moth and rust does not corrupt. I mean, it's going to be whatever you do for God will last for eternity. And we got to do a work for the Lord. We got to be children. Meet for the master's use. We're supposed to be used in this earth realm, shining our light, being salt at that season in this hour. He's looking for a church without spot or wrinkle, and we can't get caught up in that false doctrine that they're perpetrating in this earth realm, where they can lie, they can cheat, and they can steal. Because their God is the devil. And they called and they said, Christian, whatever. I don't care. We got a message for that today. The new covenant. Coming out of the Hebrews, the 9th chapter. Starting at the 8th verse, 8 to 15. And God is trying to warn his people. God is trying to tell his people what is the right road to be on. The broad road that leads to destruction, and that many be on it. But we wants to be on that straight and narrow, with righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Survives, strives, and that it's just a few on that road, and we got to be in that road, and we got to let them see us on that road that leads to life everlasting. Saints, we have a work to do in this earth realm, and time is winding down. I've told you before, and I'll tell you again, and they come to deceive and be deceived. Some of them don't even know they're being deceived. They're so ignorant in their understanding. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And because we have not, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And because you reject knowledge, because that's what the preach word is about. And everybody's not preaching the truth. But you go get the truth here. Don't care if it hurts, because it cuts like a two-edged sword. It cuts more to the bone. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come before your throne room of grace and mercy. We come lifting you up, and we come magnifying your name. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for our life, our health, and our strength. We thank you for save, deliver, heal, sanctifying, and setting us free. We ask that you bless this congregation, that you bless this pastor, the preached word, and this church. And Father God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you bless each and every household as a representative in the sound of my voice. And bless them and their households and their family and friends and our family and friends. And Father God, hide your humble servant behind the cross at Calvary and speak through me to your people what you would have them to hear, Lord. And give them ears to hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches, and a hunger and a thirst for your righteousness whereby they will be fed. And Father God, when this word goes forth with power, somebody might ask, what must they do to be saved, delivered, healed, sanctified, and set free? In Jesus' mighty name we pray and we thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Full Assurance was the Sunday school message, and it came out of the book of Hebrews, and it was at the fourth chapter of Hebrews, 9 to 20. And what were the two questions that was asked? God promised to bless and multiply who?
Abraham.
Abraham was given that promise. That promise was to Abraham. That picks up on what we're going to be speaking on today. Hebrews 6 and 14, you can go back and look at that. And God confirmed his promise with an what?
Oath.
An oath, God. Didn't that come out of Hebrews 6 and 17? God is trying to show his people, warn his people, and deliver his people from the enemy that come to kill, steal, and to destroy. The new covenant is the topic of my message. And I told you it's coming out of Hebrews, the 9th chapter, starting at the 8th verse and the 15th. And it reads, the Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. God could not bring in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit as long as his children were still in that behind the veil. You remember the priest once a year go in behind the veil. That's where they serve God. They send a priest that was clean. He had to been prostrated and he had to been clean. He'd go in behind the veil and ask for forgiveness for their sin. 9, which was a figure for the time being present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect. That wasn't what it was about. It couldn't happen. That couldn't happen as pertaining to the conscious. It couldn't make it. It could make the outside of the cup, but not the inside. Remember, he quoted that. In the gospel, Jesus did. 10, which stood only in meat and drinks and divers washings, many washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. But Christ being come and high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Neither by the blood, by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He did this for us. He's come down in the flesh and called himself Jesus, and he died on the cross for us. For at 13, if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh. The flesh. How much more the blood of Christ, who through eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. How much more would your conscience? Because he's going on the inside. It's spiritual. It's that spiritual. 15. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, if that's a seed get fallen to the ground and die, it cannot be brought. Death for the redemption of the transgression that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. The promise. The promise was given to Abraham and to his seed, with no S on it. Seed. Remember Jesus said, search the scriptures, in them you think you have eternal life, but they are they that speak of me. He's talking in types and shadows. And you have to have this revelation knowledge, which is the born again spirit in you. Remember he told Nicodemus, you have to be born again. You have to have this indwelling of the Holy Ghost to be able to decipher and to understand the scripture. Revelation knowledge. Remember I spoke to you about 2 or 3 weeks ago on the revelation. Pray that he's give you the revelation knowledge of himself, to Jesus Christ, who crucified for you. He died on the cross. He come to give it, bring in this New Testament, this new way of doing it, not to just the children of Israel, but everybody in the world. The commentator who I was studying this, he said, the Adamic race. The Adamic race is Adam. Adam, we all come from Adam and Eve, right? They were the first people on earth. God dwelt with us. It was eight covenants. And if you want, Lord, I thought you were looking. They're eight different covenants. The Adamic covenant, that's in the garden. That's in the Garden of Eden. That's why it's called the Adamic covenant. The Adamic covenant, that's Adam and Eve. That's after the Adamic covenant. That's after it ate the alpha and fell. The Noahic covenant, that's Noah. The fourth is the Abrahamic covenant. That's the promise. That's what he promised. To them that blessed you will be blessed, and those that curse you will be cursed. He's talking about the children of God, the people that believe in Jesus Christ, the one that God called out of darkness into this marvelous light. He's not talking about Israel only. That was the fleshly Israel. We're the spiritual Israel. This is the covenant. And that's the fourth, the fifth is Moses, the Mosaic, and the Palestinian. I need to do some more research on this. Palestinians fighting Israel right now. It's a Palestinian in covenant he made with the Palestinians. The Davidic covenant is David. And then we have the eighth covenant, the new covenant. God dealt in covenants, and he keeps his promises word, and he cannot change, he cannot do a new thing unless he changed the old thing. He could not, the promise was that he was trying to tell the children of Israel, since y'all cannot get this right, I'm trying to teach y'all. This is a shadow of things to come. The things to come with Jesus Christ coming to make his abode within you. And that you can make the outer part of the cup by getting the inner of the cup clean. And that's where Jesus came in. To make us clean ourselves from the inside out. Do you, follow me? That's the new covenant. That's what we're dealing with. Give me Colossians 2 and 17. And let's exegete the scripture and get y'all out of here. All right. We still on.
Yeah, you still on. I just got to find it. All right. Let me put this in here for their reading as I read it. Gotta get used to this new sling.
What you say?
Just gotta get used to this new format that I'm having to use.
You gonna go back and change it, huh? You did that time.
All right. Colossians chapter 2, verse 17. That's Colossians chapter 2, verse 17. And that reads, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ.
God chose us. He chose us out of doctor. And we cannot get to God unless we go through Jesus Christ. And how he called us is us believing in the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. Remember Romans 9 and 8? Romans 9 and 10, 10 and 9, I'm sorry. Romans 10 and 9. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That's you believe in Jesus Christ and make him your Lord and Savior, and he'll come in to make his abode. Remember the scriptures say, I in you and you in me, and we both in the Father. Jesus told his disciples that. That's the Holy Ghost. That's what he told Nicodemus. You got to be born again. Give me the Hebrews 10 and 1.
Okay. Let me get that enough for them to read. Give me one again. I actually kind of like this better.
All right, then.
Right. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. That reads.
Okay, I can't see it though. Oh, yeah, you got that.
For the law having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the thing of the things.
Yeah, I can see
that. Never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the commerce thereunto perfect.
It couldn't make them perfect. It was just making them obedient. Mm-hmm. That's all it could do. It could make them obedient. And when the wrath of God come on the children of disobedience. And that's why they kept always going into captivity. That's why we always be fulfilling the same thing. Now, as is, let's go exegete the scripture. I gave you a little bit of what the types and the shadows, what's they call it, analogies. The Holy Ghost, that see this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, the veil had to be rented. That Moses, Moses went up Mount Zion, and he came down with the Ten Commandments, white as a ghost. Hair, beard, everything. Scared the people. Man, they could not stand him. Every time he went to talk to God, he had that glow on him was so powerful, they told him to put a veil over himself. Because they didn't want to. And they, God came and talked to him one time, and they said, "Oh no, tell him don't come down. Tell him don't talk to him. You talk to him, Moses, and you come down." And the veil signified that time in their period as they were in the wilderness, when the Ten Commandments was given to them. And so they go in, they got a priest. Now he goes in behind the veil. And that veil was rented when Jesus Christ died on the cross. Remember, it said the veil was rented. And the veil was rented, that means, okay, that's done away with now. We've got a new, not just done away with it, we've got a new. God can do a new thing now. And that's Jesus Christ. He can go into the holiness of holies without a veil. And if we become his sons and his daughters, if we believe in Jesus Christ, we're able to do that now. You don't need me to do that. You believe in Jesus Christ and you have received the power of the Holy Ghost, we can go in behind the veil and speak into the holiest of holies. He said, come boldly before the throne room of grace and mercy. So we can go in now. Each and every one of us that believe in Jesus, that have the receiving of the Holy Ghost. And we can go in. That's what it's talking about in 8. 9, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifice that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience. It can only get them through by the flesh. Remember, since the carnal minded is death, carnal minded is walking in the flesh, going to church every Sunday, being a deacon, being a preacher, being a pastor, but still walking in the flesh, still going to the club, still drinking, still cussing, still fornicating, still adultery, all of them sins. And walk in the spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. And the lust of the flesh, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh. Oh, man. My mind is I'm trying to get that scripture. The lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, and that's what gets us. That's our eye gate. Man, that flesh, the pride, lust of the eye, the lust of the ear, the lust of the flesh, all of that, all of them gets us, that flesh, and we fall, and we keep getting up, and godly sorrow worketh repentance. We're trying to get this old man to be conformed to not this world, but be conformed to his world, the kingdom of God. And that sacrifice, it could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. There's no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. If walk after the spirit, man, you're going to be doing everything right. because the Holy Ghost is going to warn you and you're going to adhere to. You'll lean your member servant to obey the dictates of the Holy Spirit. You have gave him the wheel and he's driving this truck, this char, whatever. 10, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washes and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. These was happening, trying to get them to see this is his attributes. This is what he loved. This is where he's trying to get you to. And give it Romans 11, 14 to 17. You see how these scriptures keep coming into play? He's trying to tell you something. He told you once and he's telling you again.
Romans chapter 14, verse 17. That's Romans chapter 14, verse 17. And that reads, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost.
It's spiritual. It's not physical. It's not fleshly. It's not of this world. It's in this world, but it's not of this world. We're sitting in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. Man, it's the Holy Ghost is coming. Until the Holy Ghost get here, I'm going to give you some power. I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom, and whatever you bound on earth shall be bound in the heavenlies on earth, and what you loose on earth shall be loosed in the earth and the heavenlies. Whatever you bound on earth shall be bound in the earth realm and in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in the earth and the heaven. But Christ being come and high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. May God speak those things that be not as though they are. He spoke the world into existence. He spoke Adam into existence. He spoke it. And it was. He spoke the sun, the moon, and the stars into existence. He gave us the power. We can be, we're his children. We're his sons and his daughters. We can speak those things that be not as though they are. As long as they're connected to him. As long as it's going to do the kingdom business process. But Christ being coming high priest of good things to come. 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He did this for us. He knew the pain and suffering that he was going to endure. Remember in the Garden of Gethsemane? Man, he sweated drops of blood. He took Peter, James, and John to go pray with him that he might be able to go through this, that he's going to go. And the flesh rose up and said, no, he didn't want no part. So he said, Father, take this, but not my will, but thine will be done. And he came back, told the disciple, okay, I'm ready now. But the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The flesh will get you in trouble. Man, if you could follow the dictates of your flesh, you ain't going to make it. He that endured to the end shall be saved. Man, we got to follow the dictates of the Spirit in everything we do. Man, I know, man, sometimes when stuff come at you, man, and you react instead of responding, when you react, you would say, be slow to speak and quick to hear. Man, when you react, you being quick to speak. You want them to know what you got on your mind. And it's not a good thing. And it's not a godly thing. But you respond, you'll be slow to hear, and you'll be quick to hear, and you'll be slow to speak. Respond, not react. And the Holy Ghost is there leading guide you. But you have to catch yourself. Because we got to judge ourselves before we judge anybody else. We got to always judge ourselves. See, sometimes you get ready to say something about it, and you have to say, well, did you just do that? Did you just do something just like what you face to judge him on and tell him about himself? Man, you have to be mindful of you. And what you do, or be mindful of the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is going to protect you from that. He's going to catch you, man. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered once into the holiest of holies. See, God had, without the shedding of blood, there's no remissions of sin. So God had to give a blood sacrifice. People and confused about Cain and Abel. Cain's sacrifice wasn't a blood sacrifice. And Cain knew that. Yeah, Cain's still Abel. God said one way, his way, and that's the only way. He got to do it God's way and not your way. They had the cart of the tabernacle, and it was fixed in the fall. And I think it was Moses, some kind of Moses, went to grab the cart, and he died. Put his hands on it. You're not a priest. You ain't supposed to be doing that. You can't touch that. It's God, he's fixed to do something good. And he said, wow, it seems horrible, but Job was horrible. The three Hebrew boys was horrible. Joseph was horrible. David, Daniel, and the lion's den. Some horrible things happened. And sometimes you get dead behind it. For the blood of 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ... 13, excuse me. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh. Let me read that one more time. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh. That's all it did. It did what God told the Pharisees. Y'all may clean the outer portion of the bowl, of the cup, but inside is dead men's bone. I mean, you just as rotten as two left foot shoes, man. Unclean. And they call themselves, these are Pharisees, these Sadducees. These the ones that got him hung on the cross, thought they were doing God service. Oh no, they were doing their self service, because what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Because they had the power. And he said, man, y'all make them do all these things, and y'all don't even do them. And y'all standing at the gate, won't let them into the kingdom, keeping them out. because it's a change of God. Jesus been the chief cornerstone. He's been the King of Kings and the Lord's the Lord. He got a new thing coming in. 14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offer himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serving the living God. Think on that, saints. Ponder that for a minute. If this is Christ, this is what he did. He did. He died for you and me. Without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works. You want to be like your Father. You want to be just like him. That's what you're striving for. That's why you are trying to get your robe washed in the blood of the Lamb. You want to keep your integrity. You got to be a righteous man. You got to make sure if everybody else is against you, as long as you're standing for God. Stephen was the only one standing for God. You got to be bent stone to death. As long as you, and what he say? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Man, hold on to your integrity. Don't let anything or anything, man. He said, I won't let nothing separate me from the love of God. Nothing. And we got to continue in that. Give me the next scripture. Well, it's the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of earth. That's all done away with, man. Yeah, so.
Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. And that reads, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
But we can go back and forth, do the work. That's how we do the work. He anointed us. He gave us the keys to the kingdom. Whatever we bound and whatever we loose. He gave us, if my people that are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek his face and turn from our wickedness, and then will he hear from heaven and forgive us of our sins and heal the land. If we come together, all creation is groaning and moaning. We getting all of this weather and the turmoil, and all creation is moaning and groaning until we get it right. We stand in the gap. We're supposed to be the pillar and the ground of the truth. We're not supposed to be falling falsehoods, lies, and innuendos. Man, and backstabbing. And cursing and all the men talking about killing. We're not supposed to be about that. We're supposed to be about our Father's business, which is love. Love one for another, the human race. And I'm talking to the black Hebrew Israelite as if the brother doesn't mean brother. He's talking about the Israelite brother. It's one brother, man. The human race, the Adamic race. We all came from one. He said it, repented him. God said, it repent me. That man is evil continuously. Evil continuously. He wanted to throw them all away. And he got eight, Noah and his sons. And he did, got rid of everybody but knowing that they. Man, he's coming down to rapture his children from the grave and from this earth realm in the rapture. He's gonna come and he's protecting us now. Yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff shall comfort us. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life. But I forgot to, he prepares a stable table before us in the presence of our enemies. And our cup will run over. But we got to do it his way. We got to pay our tithes and our offering. We got to do the work that he called us to do. We got to go line upon line, precept upon precept. We got to do this work that we have the power. Whatever they're trying to do in Washington, D.C., or whoever they're trying to put into Washington, D.C., we have the power to fight that back. We do. But we have a stewardship that we faith without works is dead. We got to do the work. We got to do something to make sure that that don't happen, because it might not hinder you, but it's going to hinder your generations, your offsprings for some times. If don't wind down and we get up out of here. I mean, you got to be mindful of those that are least among us, that they might help, refuge and solace. 15, and for this cause, he is, did I do 15, 14?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, the Old Testament, the first testament is the sign. They which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. They which are called, many, I got that down there, yeah. Give me Matthew 22:14.
Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. That's Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. And it reads, for many are called, but few are chosen.
We on 15.
You just read it.
He called us. I remember when I first came into ministry, the minister was talking about, you didn't do that, but accept the call. Yeah, that's right. He right. I didn't do nothing but accept the call. He called me out of darkness into this marvelous light. The day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. He's calling you right as we speak. Somebody is listening to this message, and he's calling them to a greater place in him. And that we will come out of that darkness into this marvelous light. And when the thief come to kill, steal, and to destroy in this darkness, but he come that we might have life, and that more abundantly. Man, is in this light, man, you go through some hard times. Like I just said, you're going to go through trials, you're going to go through testings, and you're going to go through tribulations. But he's going to be right there. And he's going to help you be able to go through and navigate and keep your sanity and not lose your integrity, that you're still going to have love for your fellow human being, for your Adamic race. You're going to still love your God with all your heart, mind, body, and soul, and your neighbor as yourself for this cause. He is the mediator of the New Testament. He is that by means of his death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called, which is us, might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. That's another promise he gave us. Let's close it with the 1 Peter 2:9.
First Peter chapter 2, verse 9. That's 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And that reads, verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
What? I thought I had something else to say. 1 Peter 2 and 9. You're a chosen generation. Yeah, okay. I wasn't listening then. Okay, that's it.
That's okay.
Okay.
We all get there sometime.
First Peter 4 and 15. I came up with this one a little late. Hebrews 4 and 15. Hebrews 4 and 15. Let me close it with this. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was at all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin. I'm reading from the Bible, y'all. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. This is our God. He went through. He experienced. He understands. He knows how it is. He knows the spirit is willing, and he knows the flesh is weak. And all you have to do is come to him and ask for forgiveness, and he will forgive you of all your sins, and he'll put you back like he did the prodigal son and bring you back to that throne room of grace and mercy. That's what he does. He loves us that well. And he died and shed his blood for you and for me in this earth realm. And let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this word. We thank you for the new covenant that you gave, that we might partake of the tree of life. Father God, if it wasn't for your love for us, we wouldn't make it. And we thank you. We give you honor and we give you praise for taking a dying and sin-sick world and bringing us out of darkness into this marvelous light. And that we are, you took out a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praise of him who has called us out of darkness into this marvelous light. We thank you, Lord, the new covenant that you put up, you projected upon us, or you gave to us, that we might be able to come and pay homage to you in spirit and in truth. Because that's all you want us to do, is to praise you and to lift you up in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' mighty name we pray and we thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. And if anybody don't know Jesus and the pardon of their sin, say this little prayer with me. Father God, in your son Jesus' mighty name, I believe that he died, you died on the cross at Calvary, and that you shed your blood for me, for the remissions of my sins. And that on the third day, you got up, you arose, that I might partake of the tree of life, and that I make you my Lord and Savior from this day forward. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and we thank you, Lord, Go to Acts 2 and 4 and see how the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, Pentecost, took place. And Acts 5 and 32, how you have to tarry for the Holy Ghost, that you will get it if you sincerely want, if your heart is right. In Jesus' name, we pray and we thank you, Lord. This is a 501c3 ministry, and I've been shying away from telling y'all a lot of things financially does not, no. All things financially does not work. It rains on the just as well as the unjust. But your tithes and your offering mean a lot to God. If not, he wouldn't have put it in the scriptures. And everybody say, well, that's a part of the law. No, it was back in Abraham. Abraham was before the law. The law came through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. The promise came through Abraham. The promise of these blessings that you want to receive came through Abraham before the law. And you want to get then the windows of heaven to open up. There won't be room enough to receive. Go to Malachi. Check it out, man. Tithes and offering. We have a way that you can send tithes and offering. But this is a 501c3 ministry, Temple of Faith of God Church, and you can write it off on your income tax for tax purposes. This is a place to be loved, uplifted, and taught the Word of God. We still praying for a building, and we just have to wait on the Lord. And if all minds are clear, let the sweet communion of the precious Holy Ghost rest, rule, and abide until we return at the appointed time. We forever give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory that is so due you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray and we thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. What else is, have a blessed day and have a blessed week. See you next week if the Lord say the same. Have a blessed day and have a blessed week. Bye-bye. Did we get it, baby?